not only is he more knowledgeable than the rest of us, not only does he care for the subject matter that he writes about more than the rest of us, but also that as a journalist, he is simply better than the rest of us.
And also with Mesiras Nefesh, he sustained the Yiddish Stimme, the Allgemeine Journal.
He was not only a colleague, not only a friend, he was always a person with such good sense, with such wisdom, that when I needed an advice, I would turn to Gershon.
I was fascinated by his genuine personality, as you've just heard. I was intrigued by the man, his appearance, his reputation.
I was born and raised in the capital of the Soviet Union, in Moscow, where my family lived, my father and my mother. They were two beautiful people, physically beautiful. When they would go out or walk the streets, people would just stop and look at them. Because my father had a dark complexion, he was tall, very attractive man. And my mother was blonde, with blue eyes, and this combination just attracted people. August 19th, 1937, I remember it, was by the night. A car arrived, two men with guns came into the house and took away my father. For 3 years and 8 months, my mother did not know where my father is, and we didn't know. It got to a point where everybody believed that my father is dead and therefore my mother is a widow. It was all nights my mother would cry. I remember she would not sleep, she would cry. Her pillow was wet. I would go, of course, to school, public school. After I would come from school, I had a private tutor who would come and study with me Jewish subjects. This was an underground network of teachers who would teach Jewish kids the Chumash or the Gemara.
Gershon and his family were not alone in their despair. Clouds of destruction were descending upon the Soviet Union and Europe. Unprecedented devastation, unheard of in all human history, would annihilate millions of lives, demolish communities, and change the world forever. The Nazis alone brutally murdered 6 million men, women, and children for no other sin than their being Jewish. And the world was silent. Between Hitler and Stalin, the Jewish future seemed utterly hopeless. Yet, after a long night, dawn would finally break.
My father was exiled for 25 years, and suddenly a man comes and says he's alive. He was released in 1946. His spine was broken, his beard was white, and his hair was white, and he didn't recognize me, and I didn't recognize him. My grandfather, again, was a very, very educated man, and he lived with us. He had no wife, but my mother was his daughter, and after my father was arrested, I was a kid. He had a major, major influence on me. Philosophically, I would say he shaped my thinking. We left Russia after my father was freed in 1946, and we traveled. We went to Poland, we went to Germany, we went to France, Italy, Switzerland, England.
A broken people began picking up the shattered pieces. For the first time in 2,000 years, the land of Israel became a haven and a home for millions of Jews. Change, major change, was in the air. In countries throughout the world, from America to Australia, a persevering people began planting old roots in new soil, perpetuating a nation of unbounded resolve.
We went to Toronto in 1952. I was studying then in Toronto University. But then, after my father died, my mother thought that I should get a yeshiva education. So I came to the United States after she died. She died a year later. And I went to work for the Goyim, went to work for the Herald Tribune. The way I would describe how I got a job, which was very unusual, I got a good education, but I had no experience. And I just walked in and I got a job.
Despite all of his challenges, a refugee in a foreign land with a foreign language, Gershon Jacobson went on to become one of the most prominent journalists of his time, while building a beautiful family with his beloved wife, Tzivia. He was renowned for his many news scoops, most notably the capture of German war criminal Adolf Eichmann, and his interviews with Nikita Khrushchev, Egyptian leader Gamal Abdel Nasser, and Stalin's daughter Svetlana. Gershon maintained close relationships with all the leaders of his time, both in Israel and abroad. From Prime Ministers David Ben-Gurion to Ariel Sharon, from Presidents Eisenhower to Bush, Gershon interviewed politicians and people of all walks of life. He befriended world personalities while covering the most important events and prestigious organizations of the past half century. He documented the miraculous rebirth and growth of Jewish institutions in Israel and throughout the world.
For the Day Morning Journal, where I was the city editor, and I was the correspondent of Idiot Ahronot, so I had two jobs with two salaries and made a very nice living. I spent, for instance, in 1963, I went to Rome for 3 months to cover the Ecumenical Council. This is the session of the whole Catholic Church. Over 400 cardinals. The Turkmen Regional had a staff of 800 people. It was a daily paper. Typesetters and mailers and stuff. And here came a computer revolution that you can do, you can put the same paper instead of 100 people with one girl can do the same thing. So the boss decided one day if they don't allow him to buy computers, the publisher, he'll close the paper, which he did. I was the youngest on the staff. And people came to me and said, we need the paper. So 2 months after the Togmo Regional closed, and I took most of the staff that worked for the day. Some money was put in, and I began the paper, and I did not believe it will succeed. It succeeded. Jews love to argue about everything. And the paper is a marketplace for arguments. And there is no such a thing as a typical reader. I'm always amazed and surprised with the readers. Yeah. I have 5 children, 3 sons. 2 daughters. They do a lot of reading. They are all excellent communicators. Why do I have to struggle every week to put out a paper? There is a purpose here. There is a mission here. I feel it fulfilling when I see a Jew who lived through Auschwitz, who lived through hell, then he opens up the paper and smiles. You know, there is a Russian saying, I build myself a monument that you cannot build with your hands, but forever and ever, the path, the grass path to the monument will never grow any grass. Same thing here, I feel sometimes that I build up a paper, that I put in all my life in it, and it will be a monument. Everybody dies one day, you know. And after, they say, after 120 years, then I'll come for the higher court of God Almighty. He'll ask me, what did you accomplish in life? I cannot say that that I became a millionaire, that I have a portfolio of stock, that I gave each of my children a million or $2 million. I can say that I made some people smile.